Amen. Let's take our Bibles now and let's get back to our study of the Gospel of John. We're in John chapter 8 this morning. It's good to see all of you here this morning. I was walking over into the kitchen over there at the High Point Academy this morning, and I was thinking about the food that's over there. I was kind of excited about seeing the things that were going on. I was looking through the desserts, and man, you guys, you really came through this week. I was just so proud of all the desserts I saw over there. And as I was walking out, I was thinking about all the things that were there, and people were bringing in more. And I was just, oh, thank you, Lord. It's like the book of Ephesians, just more and more, abounding more and more. But anyway, I'm excited about that, and I just already taste that food, and I'm already enjoying the fellowship right now. Wanted to make a note. I know that we prayed for baby Matthew in our announcements this morning, but we wanted to say also that he is here this morning. That big baby is here. Brother Mike, are you a little proud of that boy? Why don't you stand him up and let everybody see for a second? Can you pick him up? Yeah, there you go. The little holding him up there like little Simba, you know, next king. Yeah. All right. Okay, so John chapter 8, and we're so happy for that family. John chapter 8, and we're just a very short text this morning, verses 48 through 51. John chapter 8, verses 48 through 51. We will read the Word of God together. The Bible says, "Then answered the Jews and said unto him, Say we not well that thou art a Samaritan and hast a devil? Jesus answered, I have not a devil, but I honor my Father, and ye do dishonor me. Now I seek not mine own glory. There is one that judgeth and seeketh. Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death." All right, one thing we can see very clearly in this very short text that we're looking at this morning is that the religious leaders of Israel are very angry with Jesus. We've seen that as we've been studying through this 6th, the 7th, and the 8th chapter of the religious leaders of Israel. They're supposed to be in touch with God, but they just don't get it. God's Son, the one that God sent to them, they're not listening to Him, and they don't get it. They're very angry with Jesus. He's headed for Calvary's cross to suffer and die for our sins, and plenty of anger is building up in the hearts of these men to get Him there on that cross. We've been studying through John chapter 8 over the last several weeks, and we know that they've been arguing with Jesus, and they've been confronting Him, and they've been so frustrated. Now they're so frustrated with Him that they're now resorting, as we saw in this text, to name-calling, and they're blasting Him with insults. But I want you to notice the pattern. We begin to see it all the way back there in John chapter 6. We've continued to see it consistently all the way through John 7 and all the way here into John chapter 8. Every time these religious leaders get frustrated with Jesus, they respond to Him with insults, and they treat Him hatefully. Okay, we've seen that every time. But there's also another consistent pattern we've seen, and that is that every time that they get hateful with Him and they start insulting Him, they start lashing out at Him, every time Jesus doesn't in turn get harsh back with them. Jesus simply keeps on sharing the gospel with them. He just keeps on loving on them with that same gospel message over and over again. He keeps on repeating that same message to them that the Father sent Him into the world, and if they will believe on Him, they can have eternal life. And we're going to continue to see that same pattern as we continue to study this text this morning. They're going to get angry with Him. They're going to blast at Him. They're going to insult Him, but He's just going to turn around and continue to invite them to come to know Him, to know God through Him. Now, I want to take just a few minutes to go back, because if you're just coming to verse 48 this morning, you haven't been with us the past few weeks, you haven't seen why they're so angry. I want to go back and look at some of the things, remind ourselves of some of the things that Jesus has said to these guys to get their drawers so much in a bunch, as we would say. They're so upset with Him because of the things that Jesus has said here. And so I want to go back and look at the things that Jesus has been saying, and it shows why they're so angry with Him. So back to chapter 8, verse 14, there Jesus said to them, He's talking to the religious leaders of Israel, and He says, "You do not know where I come from or where I'm going. In verse 19, he said, you neither know me nor my Father. He's telling the religious leaders of Israel they don't know God the Father. He says, if you had known me, you should have known my Father also. In verse 21, Jesus said, I go my way, ye shall seek me, and shall die in your sins. Whither I go, ye cannot come. He's saying, I'm going to die, and I'm going to go to heaven. I'm going to go to the cross, I'm going to die, I'm going to go to be with my Father in heaven, but where I'm going, you can't come. He's telling them they don't know God, and they can't go to heaven. And then in verse 23, you look down at verse 23, Jesus says to them, you are from beneath, I am from above, you're of this world, I am not of this world. I said therefore unto you that you shall die in your sins, for if you believe not that I am he, you shall die in your sins. And what Jesus was saying to them was that if you don't believe that I am, you will die in your sins. Of course, if you look in your Bibles, that word he is in italics. If you don't believe, he's calling himself by that great name of God, the great I am. He's calling himself I am. He says, if you don't believe that I am, you will die in your sins. So there's no doubt Jesus is making it clear to these religious leaders of Israel that he is God and that they are lost and that they don't know God because they will not believe in him. Therefore, they're going to die in their sins and they cannot enter the kingdom of heaven as long as they do that. These are the most religious people in Israel. Yet all of their religion that they've crammed into every inch of their lives has not brought them any closer to God than Donald Trump is to Hillary Clinton. Okay, we know that. Verse number 34, it continues. This is not all Jesus said. In verse 34, he said, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin, and the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abideth forever. He told them that they were slaves of sin rather than children of God, and that doesn't bode well on them in eternity because they're not going to be welcome in God's house for eternity. Verse 37, chapter 8, 37, he says, ye seek to kill me because my word hath no place in ye. In verse 39, he said, if you were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. And this really made them angry because they loved claiming that they were descendants of Abraham. Verse 42, Jesus said, if God were your father, you would love me. He's telling them you're not children of God because your works show that you're not children of God. And then finally, he said one of the worst things that he could have said to them, one of the things that frustrated them more than anything else. In verse 44, which we looked at last week, he said, ye are of your father, the devil, and the lusts of your father you will do. And so as we look back over all these things that Jesus has said, he's just looked into the eyes of the highly respected religious leaders of Israel, and he has publicly exposed them as phonies. He has declared to them, you guys don't know God. You're going to die in your sins. You're not going to make it to heaven. You're not God's children. You don't do the things God does. You don't even understand God's word. You're nothing more than children of the devil, and you're proving it by your hateful, murderous deeds. These are the things Jesus has said to them. And they are absolutely furious with Jesus for saying things like that. And so this morning, we come to our first point in this study, and that is the insults. The insults, because we've seen everything that Jesus has said to them, and now they're going to respond. In verse number 48, they respond. It says, Then answered the Jews and said unto him, say we not well that thou art a Samaritan and hast a devil? Okay, so we see here how they responded to all the things Jesus said to them. They just came up with a couple of the cheapest shots that they could come up with, the cheapest shots they could think of, and they just fired them off at Jesus. And that's what people do when they're losing control, when they're losing an argument, and they're in the heat of that argument, they want to win it, and they start to lose, and they can't think of anything good to say, so they just start insulting. That's, you know, so many times me and Bridget will get in an argument, you know, and most of the time she wins. Most of the time, you know, she's right about so many things, I've got to say. But so many times we'll get in an argument, and every once in a while I will come up with a point that I'm right about. Every once in a while, it's not very often, but every once in a while I'll come up with a point. And And she can't answer it. And so she'll just say, well, you're fat. You know? Okay. Yeah. It's true. Yeah. So you got a point there too. But that's what people resort to. And Bridget's not like these Pharisees are. You know, she's tender and compassionate and Christ-like and gentle with me. But we understand that throughout this entire section of Scripture, Jesus has been doing one thing and one thing only to these people, and that is He is telling them the truth. He is telling them the truth about Himself. And you know, sometimes the hardest thing to do is to confront people with a difficult truth. That is sometimes a tough thing to do. Some people don't want to hear the truth, and they'll hate you for looking them in the eyes and telling them the truth. I'll never forget one day back when I was in junior high school, I was standing out in front of the school that I attended, and I was talking to one of my friends, and we were just standing there face to face, and I was trying to tell him some funny story. I was trying to tell him about something that I thought was hilarious, and as I'm telling him, friends of mine are standing around. As I'm telling him this story, I'm expecting him to laugh. He stops me right in the middle of the story, and he says, Chris, dude, seriously, your breath stinks. And can I tell you, guys, in that moment, all my friends standing around hearing that, I felt beyond ashamed. I was so deeply embarrassed by that, that he told me that. There was a similar thing that happened to me not long after that, kind of the same year. And it was a Saturday morning. We were at church. It was after Saturday morning bus visitation, and we were getting off the bus. I'm standing in line waiting to get off the church bus, and there was a girl in line right behind me, and I really liked the fact that that girl was right behind me because she was so cute, and I had a crush on this girl. And I want to tell you, that girl leaned forward, and she put her hand on my shoulder and pulled me back so she could whisper something in my ear. And I was thinking, oh yeah, she's digging me. This girl really likes me. She got up there close, and she whispered, she said, Chris, you stink. Oh man, I didn't want to hear that. And I have to tell you again, it hurt my feelings. It deeply embarrassed me. And it was so difficult for me to hear that from her. But you know, looking back on those two events, I'm really glad that those two people said those things to me. And I'm sure that you as a church are probably glad that those people said those things to me, because that's what it took for me to finally realize why people didn't want to sit by me at the lunch table. That was the year that I actually started using my toothbrush and that I actually started taking real showers and using the soap and the shampoo, and I actually started using the deodorant that my mom was buying me. I mean, I hated to hear that. It deeply embarrassed me, but both of those humiliating events greatly helped me in my life. Do you understand what I'm saying to you today? What if I had never got past that in my life? We grow sometimes through facing hard truths. How many problems would it have caused me if I'd never realized I had that problem? How far could I have made it in the ministry without making some changes? People would have been talking about me behind my back, calling me Preacher McStinky Breath all the time. And I know that there were probably a whole lot more kids out there that were talking about me, making fun of me during that time. But there were only two young people that actually cared deeply enough for me to look me in the eye and confront me with that embarrassing truth that I smelled like rotten cheese. And if I could go back today, guys, if I could go back and speak to those two young people today, I would say to those two people, thank you, guys. You changed my life. And you see, Jesus is looking these religious leaders in the face, and He actually cares enough about them to say, hey guys, you stink. I can smell what you got going on in your hearts, and it's not good. And yes, this embarrassed them. They didn't want to hear it, even though the cold, hard truth is the only thing that can help them, even though the truth is the only thing but that could set them free, they didn't want to hear it. And here's the problem. Instead of recognizing the fact that Jesus was trying to help them, instead of being thankful to him for the fact that he's actually trying to lead them to heaven, they just responded by hating him. And they couldn't think of anything better to do than to just start hurling insults at him. And that's what we're seeing here in verse 48. Thou art a Samaritan, and thou hast a devil. They were humiliated, and so they're angry with him, and they're lashing out at him with insults. And that remark about him being a Samaritan, that's what they meant as an insult. It's really not an insult if you think. It's very racist for them to think that's an insult. But can you insult somebody for just being born in a certain country? They didn't choose that. And that this actually goes right along with the things, you know, that they've already been insulting Jesus already. And a few weeks earlier when we were studying through the earlier parts of John chapter 8, we saw there where they said to Jesus, they said, "We were not born of fornication." We saw that part where they said to Jesus, "Where is your father?" And that's when they were just kind of attacking Jesus' family, and they were attacking the character of his mother and father, saying, "You know, we don't believe that story that Mary made up about an angel coming to her, the angel of the Lord telling her that the power of the Most High is going to come upon her. We don't believe that miraculously virgin-born story. We believe it because it's in God's Word." But this is what they were saying to Jesus, and here they're just kind of adding to that. They're saying, "You know, for all we know, you are the it's a bad word, but it's in the Bible, the bastard son of a Samaritan." That's the worst kind of insult that they could think of to try to treat him with. And then to say that he has a demon, that's their way of trying to discredit him, because people know Jesus is for real. Everybody has seen what Jesus could do. Nobody could deny his power. And so they just tried to explain his miracles away by saying, "You must be getting your power from the devil. You have a demon helping you, not from God." And the sad thing for them is that in doing this, they're treading in the area of that unforgivable sin that Jesus describes as blasphemy of the Holy Spirit by looking at the power of the Holy Spirit in the works that Jesus did and attributing that to the power of the devil instead. That is blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, and they are treading on that ground, and so they are in danger. And so they're just trying to ramp up their insults towards the character of Jesus here. And they're trying to discredit him in every way that they can. And it's interesting, there's no profanity in the Hebrew language. There was no way that you could cuss somebody out in Hebrew. If you guys spoke Hebrew, I don't know what you would say when you drive, because I've seen some of you. No cuss words in Hebrew. So the worst possible way that they knew to tell somebody off in their language was to call them a fatherless child, or to call them a Samaritan, or to actually accuse them of being possessed by a demon. And that's what they did all here. This was their way of kind of cussing Jesus out. That's the worst thing they could think of to say to Jesus, and that's what they did right here. They just insulted him in every way they could. Secondly, this morning, as we move on, we're going to look at the implications of all this. Because there are some consequences to the actions these guys are going to take. The wickedness of these men who are lashing out at Jesus and they're insulting Jesus, there are some consequences to their actions. And Jesus is about to tell them this. In verse 49, Jesus answered, "I have not a devil, but I honor my Father, and ye do dishonor me." These guys have lost their grip on reality. They've stood in the presence of Jesus Christ, and they've been eyewitnesses to the undeniable miracles of Almighty God worked by His hand. Yet rather than accept the truth that's right in front of their eyes, they're grasping at straws. They're so stubborn that they're trying to believe in something that's actually harder to believe than the truth is. Kind of like these people, you know, these people that believe that everything we see around us just happened by chance. Man, it takes more faith to believe that than to believe that God created everything that there is. This cannot be an accident. You know why? Because my eyes are in front of my head. If this was an accident, my eyes would be in back, okay? I wouldn't. If this was an accident, you know, things would not be the way that they are. I wouldn't have little fingernails on the end of my fingers where I can pick up stuff off the ground that's hard to pick up. God designed us so meticulously. God designed everything that's around us so meticulously, and the heavens declare His glory. We wouldn't have half of the time light for us to be out working, and we wouldn't have dark for us to be at home sleeping and relaxing. We wouldn't have water on this earth that we need, and rain, and all the things that God has provided for us. God has given us, the whole creation just declares the glory of an awesome Creator God. And it is harder to believe that this happened by accident than it is to actually believe that an almighty God designed it all and made it just the way He wanted. And I even was watching a scientist the other day on Discovery, and I was watching a video where this scientist is talking about how we got here. And he talked about every theory in the world, and he even talked about the thought that it might be possible that aliens once came and dropped us off here on this planet. And I thought, oh, we can't even mention the thought. We would be fools if we mentioned the thought that maybe God created us all in His image, but oh, we're gonna accept the thought that maybe little green men dropped us off here in their flying saucer. It's harder to believe. And this is what these guys are doing. They're in such denial. They have seen the miracles of Jesus. They have seen how compassionate they are. These works that Jesus is doing cannot be the works of the devil, but they're saying, you have a devil. Rather than believe the obvious truth, they're grabbing on to anything else they can believe, and they're trying to discredit Jesus. And so Jesus says, you guys are trying to explain me away, but I'll tell you what's really going on. I don't have a demon. I do not have a demon. That's not what's going on here. But I will tell you what's really going on here. What's really going on here is I am honoring my Father, and you are dishonoring me. And you understand what Jesus is saying. He's saying to these guys that they're dishonoring God the Father by dishonoring His Son that He sent. If you dishonor the Son, you dishonor the Father. It's the very same way with us. Brother Jeremy, I consider Brother Jeremy a friend, you know. Brother Jeremy, he's my neighbor. It wasn't long after we moved in that he decided he's going to move away. But get out of that neighborhood fast. But Brother Jeremy, love you, man. You're my friend. I appreciate you. Just don't like your wife very much. You just ruined that illustration. He said, me neither. No, that wouldn't be acceptable because I know Brother Jeremy. He would say, no, I love my wife. And if you're going to be my friend, if you're going to love me, you have to love my wife too, right? And that's what I would say about my wife. Bridget, I love you. And if you love me, you got to love my wife too, you know. I'm not going to, you know, if you come to me and say, you know, I love you, Brother Chris, but I just can't stand that Daniel. Sits up there, beats on those drums, and thinks he's all cute because he's sitting by Kyra. I say, no, that's my son. And there may be things about him that grate on your nerves. I understand that. But I love him still. I love him still. God says, you're going to say you love me, you love my son too. You're going to say that you know me, you got to know my son. It's the same way with us as it is with God. You want to be my friend, you say you love me, I expect you to love everybody in my family. And God says the same thing to us. If you want to say that you love him, you have to love his son too. If you want to know the Father, you have to know the Son. If you reject the Son, you've rejected the Father. If you have dishonored the Son, you've dishonored the Father. And so these guys have come up with the best kind of insult that they could think of, and they made up some lies about Jesus, and Jesus just turns it around here. He says, no, that's not what's going on. What's really going on is that the God you guys claim that you're so close to, you're actually dishonoring because you're dishonoring His Son. And then in verse number 50, he says, and I seek not my own glory. There is one that seeketh and judgeth. Who do you think Jesus is talking about? There's one that seeketh and judgeth. He's talking about His Father. And what He's doing, He's warning these guys, the Father is going to judge you for dishonoring His Son. He's saying to them, you all are dishonoring me, but you know what? I don't really care about that. I'm not here looking for a pat on the back. It's not my purpose to seek my own glory. He says that in verse 50. I seek not my own glory. I only want to glorify my Father. I only want to glorify my Father. He wasn't here to glorify Himself. Jesus was never trying to glorify Himself. Was he trying to glorify Himself when He stepped down out of heaven, out of the throne room, and took on human flesh? Absolutely not. I mean, he was laying aside His glory. He was humbling Himself, laying aside that glory. And He said, there is one that seeketh and judgeth. Only the Father is still in the throne room of heaven, seeking for His children to glorify Him. But the Son, right now, the Son is too busy humbling Himself and being obedient unto death, even the death of a cross, Philippians chapter 2. And do you know what else He means when He says that? He says, there's one that seeketh and judgeth. This is a warning. He's saying, you know what? I'm not going to be the one to bring judgment down on you because you're dishonoring me. The Son of Man did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. I'm too busy saving. And so you're not going to make me hate you and bring my wrath down on you because you've acted hateful to me. There's one who judges. There's one who's going to judge. You're not going to make me put my wrath on. But I will tell you this, when you dishonor me, you are dishonoring the God that you claim is your Father. And I want you to understand, He will judge you. This is a warning. Jesus is saying, I don't care about my own glory. It's all about my Father's glory. But He does care about my glory. My Father cares about my glory, He says. And if you dishonor me, He will judge you. These are the implications. These are the consequences of what these guys are doing. They're putting themselves under the judgment and the wrath of God. And finally this morning, the invitations. It's our final point this morning. In verse number 51, Jesus says, after all this harshness, after all this hatred, Jesus looks at these guys. He says, verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death. And do you see that? Just like we said before, every time Jesus confronts these guys with their sin and their error, every time they get angry with Him and they lash out at Him, He shows them how desperately lost they are, and they get so angry with Him and they're insulting Him. But Jesus, the way Jesus reacts to that is not to insult them in return. He always offers them a heartfelt, kind, compassionate invitation. If a man keep my saying, he shall never see death. Guys, look at the opportunity that's before you. All you have to do is believe. Trust me. He always invites them all to come, believe in Him, receive eternal life. And it's the same pattern we see here. And I want to tell you, there's no other way that you can explain what's happening here except just to call this the compassionate love of Jesus Christ. Because I can guarantee you, if it was somebody else being treated this way, if a group of people was treating you or me like these guys were treating Jesus, if they were rejecting us and telling lies about us and insulting us and fighting against us like these guys were doing, we would want to toss them out and tell them to never come back. That's the way we react. We're so defensive. But Jesus being reviled, reviled not again, the Word of God tells us. And as wicked and as cruel as these guys acted towards Him, Jesus just looks on them with compassion, and He invites them to believe in Him and receive eternal life. And he says, if you keep my word, you'll never perish. You'll never see death. What a compassionate invitation to such a hateful group of people. It reminds me that just 6 months from this time we're talking about right here, he's going to be arrested. And he's going to be mocked. And he's going to be brutally tortured and crucified. And while they're doing these cruel things to him, he's going to cry out from that cross that he's nailed to. And he's going to pray, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Where your love